classroom he's in, and, you know, helping like adding a little extra stress to the day. So content comprehension, student engagement in career and technical education, post-secondary flipped classroom, big one for me. How many of you, well, how many are first year students? Okay. And second year students, this would be a question for. Any of you experienced any days when you just didn't want to go to class? Didn't want to go there for the weekend?
Oh, no.
Where I should be right now is there. My kids are racing RC cars today, and it's their first year doing nitro cars. And I was perfectly cool and calm about this presentation, not worried a bit. And then they were racing over lunch hour, we were watching it live online, and they broke. So when I leave here, we're going to the cities to pick up parts and try and get them back on the track for tomorrow. So a little added stress for today. So flipped classroom. Last year when I came here as a first year student, flipped classroom, I mean, it sounded cool. I've seen books about it, but I didn't know what it was. And we went to, I'm gonna sound like Aaron all over again. It was the last presentation of the day. And it was a fifth grade teacher, I can't remember what school he was from, but he had his classroom decorated like Buffalo Wild Wings and had a bathtub in there that they could sit in and read their books. And it was about flipped classroom. And I have one particular class that I teach that it just, that's what I have to do. I have to try it. Because where I teach, I do a little bit different. I have a basic engine class that runs the first 8 weeks of class. And then I have this lawn and garden class that it's the only class they have for 2 weeks. So all day, every day for 2 weeks, it's all lawn and garden. And in 2 weeks, it's next to impossible to get all the content in. And you know, you only have three chainsaw sharpeners, and it's hard to get around and get them to do all the projects. So what I did is when I saw this flipped, I thought, my gosh, I can do all my demonstrations and they can do that as homework. And then when they come to class, they have more shop time, more hands-on. And I thought that was gonna work fabulous. So there's a few different ways of doing a flipped classroom. The one that I chose was videotaping my demonstrations and lectures and having them watch that at home as their homework. And then when they came to class, it was just straight shop time. And if any of you are thinking about it or planning to do it, the hardest thing I think about making the videos is having to listen to yourself. You know, I had no idea I sounded so much like a northern Minnesota redneck, you know, but it comes through pretty clear in the videos. In my research, I was noticing that there's some teachers that I can't remember what book it was out of anymore. That posted videos on YouTube. They had a Facebook page. They had their own personal website. They had like five or six different places for students to get the information. And I don't know about your students, but my students and myself, I don't want any more passwords than I have to have. You know, I don't want to have to log into three different places to do the work. So being part of the Minn State system, we use D2L Brightspace. And D2L Brightspace requires a login. And we struggle with our students checking their emails, which requires a completely different login. So I kind of did something that I wouldn't recommend if you're doing research. I did two things at once. I got rid of using D2L and flipped it at the same time. And what I used was Microsoft Office 365. That's where our students' emails are. So when they log in to check their emails, one click over is OneNote Classroom, and we used OneNote Classroom for all the videos, all the handouts, everything they needed to access was right there, one click away from their email. So when we look at total results at the end, I don't know, did I screw it up? Did we get good results because of the flipped classroom, or good results because the content was easier to get to and access? I guess I don't know, and that's That's the problem with the way I did it. So, I like to open it in a regular OneNote. Students could access it in their if we have to log in, I just won't do it. We'll go back to where we were. This is what students could access without putting anything else on their computer. They can access it online. They don't have to have the Microsoft Office suite. It's all free online. I know the last hour we heard, and all through the 2 years, I've heard that K-12 uses Google Chrome a lot, or Google Classroom, because it's free. Microsoft Office 365 is free to schools too. So when IT says, you know, we do Google because it's free, that really isn't the case. But Google was first, so now that they've started Google, it's kind of hard to go switch tracks, you know. But anyway, in the content library, they could access all the handouts. You know, if they wanted to learn about belts, they click on belts. Each one of these is a separate folder based on topic. So the one I'm going to share with you is saw chain. One of the things we do is we make chain, the right length for chainsaws. We sharpen it. We do it with machines. We do it with files. We do several different ways. So one of the handouts that they would see would be this one. And it talks about the parts of the chain. So the idea is they look at these handouts first. This is something that normally I would hand out on a piece of paper in class. They can save this to their own computer, have it forever if they want, don't have to lose the papers. But this is the terminology one, so they would go through this prior to watching the video. And they would learn things like, I'm gonna show you one of the videos, and it talks about the heel and the toe. So they would have watched this previous, so they know what a heel and toe is. And then I hosted the videos through Office 365 too, again, so that everything's in one spot, and we don't have to worry about, does it work with this learning system or not? This one here.
Okay, now we're going to rivet the chain back together. The first thing we need to do is,
I should pause it for a second. It's a high production deal. I mean, very professional videos. I had my 13-year-old son stand there with my Surface Pro and tape the video. So, and it wasn't, one of the things they recommended was get good quality microphone, because it's oftentimes in the video you're hard to hear. I tried it with just the Surface Pro and it worked. So we stuck with it, and yeah. Would I do the videos differently? Probably a little bit. Here I am just a talking body with hands, you know. If we back up a little bit, they can see their face, which I didn't really see was a benefit to them. They can look. The main thing is I wanted to see what was being done and do it as firsthand as possible. So if you're planning to do this or thinking of doing it, just do it. The videos aren't going to be perfect the first time around. I got done with one putting a carburetor together, and the very last part was a little tiny spring about that big, and it went flying across the room. So I did that one over. But the others, I mean, yeah, there's going to be glitches. You could sit there for hours and do them. But just do it and get it done, and you can always go back and refine things later.
Look and see what size anvil we have in here. Now, the anvil has a hexed edge to it. It looks like a wrench could go on it. Please do not put a wrench on there. It's not threaded, it just slides in. So I'm just gonna take a plier here and pull this one out. It'll pull straight out. And if we look at the back side of it, we can see this is a letter B. The 3/8 chain that we're doing requires a letter A. So I'm gonna slide the letter A in there instead. And again, it just slides in, so don't put any wrenches on it. When we go to put the chain together, we're going to use a preset tie strap. We looked up the right one for this chain, keeping in mind to keep the heel and toe facing down. And then we have a regular tie strap, making sure the heel and toe are facing down.
That's the number one thing they mix up, is they get them upside down and have to do them over again, so that's why I emphasize that.
So I'm going to just put it together by hand here first. If we don't get the right preset tie strap and tie strap on here, then we're going to have a problem with the chain binding. So we have to look up to make sure we have the right part for it. Set the chain in there, and of course it came apart.
Sometimes if you're fumbling, like it coming apart on me right there, they feel a little bit better.
Trying to keep my fingers out of the way so you can see what's going on, but
it doesn't have to
fall apart if I do that. So. Set down in there and then we'll look at it. Okay, so now I have the rotating handle side on the side with the rivet sticking out. The preset tie strap is already pinned on one side, and that's where we're going to move this handle in to center it. Okay, so I'm just snugging it up. We don't have any tension on it at all yet. I'm going to put a little bit of oil on it. You know, if you're in a chainsaw shop, bar oil will work fine, motor oil, anything, so we just don't have metal to metal contact. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to gently turn this handle in, put more pressure on the rivet, and rotate the handle so it peens over the rivet. So I'm going to put some pressure on it while rotating the handle. And I want you to be careful and not go too tight. Back it off now, and then I'll slide it forward and do the next one. If we get it too tight, we have to start the process all over again. We have to break the chain and so I'm going to stop there and just see how close we are. When we look for closeness, this is the link I just did, and you can see it's much too loose. It wiggles around. What we wanted to do is fit like the stock one did. So we have quite a ways to go. But I'd rather stop here than get it too tight and then have to break it all over again. So we line it up, we still got plenty of lube there. And then do the next one again. And again, we want it just about where this manufacturer had theirs. So now, as far as back and forth play, it's pretty snug. Pretty similar to what the manufacturer's is. And we have nice, clean, riveted ends. That's how you splice the chain. Again, making sure the heel and toe are facing down.
Okay, so part of showing that is if you're thinking about doing it or whatever you're thinking about doing for your research, it doesn't have to be perfect. And I can't remember. Oh, yes, when I was here, we had a speaker that I forget what his topic was about, but. What I took away from that presentation was that if he can do it, I can do it. You know, it wasn't rocket science. It was something doable. Just pick something that you enjoy, something that will help your class, and just do it. When doing the research, the videos, there was actually one book where the lady that was writing it talked about how long a video should be. And she went on YouTube and just started watching videos and found that about 14 minutes, she started getting fidgety and bored with whatever was on there, even if she was interested in it. So keeping the video short, you know, typically if you're teaching a class, you have like a 50 minute section, make five videos, break it up. So you got five videos and they can watch it at their leisure. It's quick and easy to watch it. What a lot of students said, we'll get to that later, I guess, is they found value in being able to watch the video over again. They watched it at home, they understood it, they get to the shop and they're gonna go do it, and it's like, oh, how do I do that again? Well, if there's, say there's 20 people in the class and just me, it's a lot easier, they can just pull it up on their phone, watch the video again, and they don't have to have me there helping. I certainly would help them if they had problems, but they didn't have to wait in line for that. So it was an added value for them based on that. So again, I guess I told you this beforehand, before I got to the slide, Marine Small Engine Essential Use College, the limited lab time, that's why I chose the lawn and garden. And what I did is I don't have two sections of the class, so I can't compare them side by side. So what I compared was last year's students to this year's students. And for the first time, I taught there 16 years. For the first time in 16 years, we actually have low enrollment in class. And it actually worked out perfectly. We had 9 students in both sections, so it was almost identical. Our students vary from age 18 to 65 years old. We have students that are there just to learn to tinker and want to do it in their garage when they retire. So, and we have that in both first and second year group. Computer skills, you worry about that when you're watching videos. And they varied from very skilled in being able to do just about any program you put out there to wondering where the on-off button was. I had a student a few years back that it took a long time. He was arguing with his son trying to learn how to use the computer and was arguing about something that was on his desktop. I thought this was his desktop. You know? So we have very varying abilities. But we had time that if they had to, they could watch the videos there at school. But everybody did have access to devices and was able to view them outside of class. And I verified that everybody had devices. If not, I mean, we had some that we could probably sign up to them or find ways to get them access. So what I compared was their, well, a few different things. The first one being their final exam scores. And the blue line is the non-flipped classrooms that would have been last year's class, and the red is this year's class. When I was researching, I found a place where, a couple different places where they said that this really helped the high achievers do better. And I guess my research showed the opposite. If they're a high achiever, they're gonna be a high achiever regardless of how you give them the information. But what I liked here is we had a lot more B's this year than last year. So the flipped classroom, we had more B's. We had less C's. We did have more D's, but look at what happened to F's. We had fewer F's too. So what I'm seeing is that some of our C's went up to the D category, and some of our F's went up to the D category. And that's my goal, that's what I want. I want to see improvement. Again, in the research model, it's not perfect because you're comparing two different classes, two different groups of students with different personalities, different learning skills, different, you know, so this isn't concrete evidence, but continuing it over a few years, you can probably start to see trends. And see how it helps. Lab grades in my classes, lab grades are always gonna have a lot of A's. Because if they go and they do a project and they don't do it successfully or they don't do it to the standards that it needs to be, I show them what they did wrong or what they got wrong and have them go back and do it again and keep doing it until we're proficient at it and do it right. So most of our grades are gonna be A's in that lab group. I don't accept it until it passes the standards and is done the way it needs to be. So in this picture, yeah, we have a lot of A's, which is always gonna be in the lab portion. But the non-flip class, we had a B and an F. Now the F, I don't remember, the student did complete the course. He went through the whole time, but he didn't finish all the lab projects. So if you don't finish it, yes, you failed it. In the flipped model, yeah, this ideally this one can drop back to there, but we got that F to jump up two spaces. Again, different personalities, it may not just be because of the flipped model, but I'm gonna feel good and say it was. And we'll try it again next year and see what happens. I'm gonna use Chris as an example because he's the actual student that said this. After Lawn and Garden was over, we were into snowmobile systems, and I had done a demonstration on a rebuilding a primary clutch on a snowmobile, and 2 days later he was rebuilding the clutch and he's like, I wish I had a video to look at, because I remember most of it, but I'm wondering about this part, you know. And I mean, it really struck home that yes, it was beneficial and helpful. So next year's going to be even more interesting. We're going to flip some more classes, I think. Overall final grades. We had, again, the high achievers were high achievers, regardless of how they got it. A little bit lower in B's, but all of these D's and F's disappeared, and the lowest grade I had in the flipped model was a C for overall grade, meaning the tests, the quizzes, and the lab work. So, in my work, that's a fabulous win. So, we're gonna keep trying it and keep doing it. The other thing I did is I surveyed the students afterwards, and I didn't do it anonymously. I probably could have and should have, but I really do have a good group of students. And I told them they were gonna get points for doing the survey. And the points have nothing to do with what you put on the survey, just the fact you did it. And I said, what you tell me is gonna dictate whether we continue doing this or don't do this. Because regardless of how good I feel about it, think how wonderful I'm doing, if the students think it sucks, it doesn't matter, you know? So I wanted their honest feedback, and they did. They gave me honest feedback. What they liked about it, you know, I liked that we could work at our own pace. The videos are nice, you can access and watch them as many times as you want. There were really a lot of good comments as to being able to rewatch them, what they liked about it. They really did a nice job, I think. Gave us more time in shop. That was the whole objective right there. And again, I didn't change their spelling any, so if they see errors here, it's just that I know to capitalize I. What did you not like about this flipped classroom method? My favorite two are that we still had homework. That sucked, apparently. And my all-time favorite, though, what I didn't like about flipping the classroom is that if you don't pay attention to what you need to do, you get behind and lost with stuff to do. Imagine that, you know? And that's what really, you know, I was looking at this strictly from the standpoint of I want more time and I want to be able to get to all the lab projects. What I wasn't expecting but got was they had to take more ownership of their education. You know, it wasn't me standing in front and regurgitating to them. They had to go and watch the videos. They had to do the projects. Because the other thing I did, it's a 2-week class. I just posted the videos and said, the only due date is all this has to be done in 2 weeks. I'd maybe change that a little bit if I wanted to think of a full semester class. But in 2 weeks, you know, people like Chris would be bored if I handed them out one at a time, or there's others that one at a time probably needed it so they didn't get lost with stuff to do, you know? But it did require them to take ownership of the class, and that was kind of a cool side effect that I wasn't expecting. But a lot of them, this one here, and Chris can probably correct me because he told me at lunch he was gonna heckle me and say, that's not the way you did it, Paul. And I don't honestly remember. I think the day before class started, I opened it up and showed everybody how to access the videos so they could watch them over the weekend. And this one here, you know, it was very slow getting started. On day one, I still didn't watch the videos. I think videos should be available a few days in advance. I think I did. I think I gave it to them the weekend ahead so they could watch them. And then what I did is I started every class with just a question and answer session. Did you watch something last night you didn't understand? You know, just clearing up any confusions. So it actually worked out pretty good. I liked it. Would you like to see more classes done this way? Across the board, every single one of them said yes, which was huge. I mean, I thought it was great. I mean, I thought it was a good way to do it, but they validated it here. Is that anything you feel would be important about flipping classroom? One was talking about our small class size and that, you know, if we had more students, we need more instructors, and that's always the case in career tech ed. I mean, you're never gonna have enough bodies to help with questions and whatnot. Nothing, great system. I like how you watch the videos. Let us download the videos and everything so we can always have it. I didn't do that. I gotta go back and burn them onto a DVD and give them to them, because what I didn't want to do, and I probably just from my selfishness, is I hosted them through Office 365, and that would be accessible to anybody in the MnState system if I made them public. And to make them public, then you could download them. But
Alexander?
I didn't want Mike over here, or Mark rather, stealing my videos, you know. Not that he would steal my videos, but, I'm just testing it. I didn't want to throw it out there to the public. So they weren't downloadable. I may change that as we go. Were the videos easy to access? I wanted to make sure they weren't too big of a file size so that they had a hard time getting them. Everybody said they're easy to access. Everybody said they downloaded just right. You know, because if it downloaded too slow, maybe I'd cut back on the quality of the videos so that if they have temperamental internet in the country, they could access it better. But everybody said it loaded just fine. What best describes the visual quality of the videos? Good, bad, or adequate? And there were a couple of adequates, and you guys saw the video. It's adequate. You know, it wasn't what I'd call good, but it was done, and it was accessible, and now there's things to improve on. I gave them just a 5-star rating system, and they rated it 4.3 out of 5. So I think that's pretty good. And I think part of that was the not being able to download them and what have you. Is that my last slide? I think there's maybe one more. No, there's two more. Nope. I had to add this at lunchtime because Aaron was talking about this morning about how others in the school district maybe are not as open to trying something new. You know, this is a kind of a weird way of running a class, you know, and that's not how we do things. I know in career tech ed at Central Lakes College, flipped classroom is not how we do things. So I did it, I tried it, and having heard that, this was my favorite quote that I found when researching it. We should aggressively go out of our way to teach for better ways to help our learners demonstrate learning with the types of products and performances that match our times. If we do not do this, then we should change our mission statement to reflect the desire to hold on to the past. You know? And that's exactly it. When I sat down with Denny 2 years ago, right before class was to start, I had no clue I wanted to go get my master's degree. I did it for all the wrong reasons. I wanted a pay raise. And I've been teaching 16 years. If you were here in the last session, you heard Scott in career tech ed. It's typically somebody that has worked in the field and goes into teaching and has no teaching experience. I've been teaching for 16 years. The stuff I learned in this class, I wish I'd learned 15 years ago. It really was. It was phenomenal, you know? And I hope you guys go at it with an open mind like that and do the same, because I did. I was strictly looking for pay. And with what I learned, I could care less. Well, I care about the pay, but if there wasn't a raise, it would have still been very worth it. You know, it was a very good system. that was the end of it. As far as books go, yeah, I turned the lights down. You know, it was after lunch, the room's warm. I was kind of hoping somebody would fall asleep. But these two books are books that last year when I went to the presentation about flipped classrooms, these are the two that they said were the absolute best and they got the most information out of. They're very good. I'll leave them up here if you're interested in looking at them. What I found though was a lot of the books were anecdotal. You know, they would talk about what they did to flip the classroom, but no real data as to how things changed, you know. It was more like, I feel the students did better, I feel they liked it, you know. It wasn't necessarily research like what we're supposed to be doing. There was one book, Best Practices for Flipping the College Classroom. There's five or six different case studies in here that are very much like our action research project with data and results. And I mean, this is the one that helped me probably the most of all of them, because it was actually, you know, five cases that did basically what we're doing, and seeing how they did the results helped with me doing the results. There's a lot of books out there, but it's that was probably my most beneficial one. The thing I want to leave you with before I ask for questions is, if you're like me, you maybe think this sounds like a cool idea and you might want to do it next year, and you get home and you're like, oh, I wish I'd asked that question. And this goes for any of the, well, I'm going to speak for myself. You can choose what you want with others. Inside here, there's descriptions of them, and all the presenters' emails are there. So if you think something about flipped classroom, or I know a couple of you were in here last group and were CTE instructors. If you have any questions, feel free to email me at any time. I'm dumb enough to check my emails in the summertime too, so feel free to do so. When I say that, you know, I forget to ask right at the moment. I was going to tell you at the beginning of the session to ask questions whenever they came up, but now we're at the end, so does anybody have any questions? Yes?
So how long were your videos available for?
The whole 2 weeks.
And then you just...
Actually, no, they're still available now. Even though the class has been over since November, they can still access it. I lied. They're still available, but Minnesota State did a change with the way we log into our system, so I am going to have to refresh it for them to be able to see it, but they will still be able to see it. Yeah. So that's another reason why I used that OneNote, which, again, was Denny wasn't here for that, so we just won't talk about that. I accidentally did two things at once and could have skewed results, we don't know. But it was helpful, so I did it anyway. Yeah.
And do you think you'll make like new videos for next year, or do you think you'll use the same ones?
There's a couple of these videos that I'll do over again. I want to do videos for all the classes, even though I don't flip them, just to have them as information and that they can go back and watch them. Because like that video that I showed you, that was a front row seat to the demonstration. If you're in a classroom with 20 people and there's three lines, the people in the back didn't get to see that, mm-hmm. You know? So even if you're doing a live demonstration, I think I'd still want the video there just for them to go back to and look at. So with all the demonstrations I do, I probably won't redo all those next year, but as I get more, I'll go back and correct them or improve them, you know? But the big thing is just get it done, do it. It's not gonna be perfect. If I do that video 20 different times, it's still not going to be perfect, you know? It's going to get better each time, but nobody's going to do it perfectly. No other questions? I didn't do that good of a job. There have to be questions.
How much time do you spend editing?
Editing?
Yeah, each video.
None.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. The only editing I did is like, I was mentioning that one where I was rebuilding the carburetor and spring flew. I just started over and did it over again. You know? Well, yeah, that's true, but when bifocals, it took me a while to find the spring.
Yep,
exactly. Yep. Actually, my students hate it when we lose small stuff on the ground because I tell them to get out of the room. Because when you're sweeping that dirt, that part's gonna roll out ahead of the dirt and you're gonna find it. So that's what I did, you know. But anyhow, I could have added it and then I'd be over the 15-minute video mark. And then they get bored and quit watching it, so, yeah.
I think that's true.
Yeah, it's, I mean, that's a big thing. I really concentrated on making sure all the videos were short.
I think that's true in any classroom, though.
Yeah, yep. Because like the one we watched, that was putting a chain together. There was a 4-minute video prior to that that was taking it apart, you know? So they watch them in steps and they get to do it in order. But yeah, keep it short so that, you know, even if they go back to it, they don't have to sit through 5 minutes to get to the part they want, you know? Any other questions? Yeah.
Is it like YouTube where it shows you how many views there are, or like can you see who's?
Yeah. If I. No. When I made it private, that went away. Prior to making it private, before the class started, I put it out there just to see how it would work, and. In all of Minnesota State, these are the only channels that are out there on the video. And only one says what program they were. I mean, small engine, essentially, scholars. But prior to, you know, like this one here, had, well, the one I showed you today, 26 views, but it had probably 15 views before class even started. So somebody at system office must have seen that I was putting stuff on their video page and they were looking to see what it was, you know. But then I locked it down so only my students could see it, and it didn't track it beyond that. So that would be something. Maybe I do throw them out there, and you know. But there's all the videos that I had for the 2-week class, and I think the longest one is there's a 7-minute one. 8 minutes and 33 seconds was the longest one. So very easy to do. You know, in the research, they were even talking about bigger cities where you're commuting maybe on a train and break out their phone and watch their lecture on the train. You know, it makes use of downtime. So, any other questions? What time is this supposed to be done?
3:05.
3:05, well, then it has to be more questions. I can keep talking about it. But if you guys have questions about, and you know what, even if it's not supposed to be, if you have questions about the research project, whether it's flipped classroom or not, just the process of doing it, do you have any questions on that? Have you thought about it yet? Have you started it yet? I'm not going to have you raise your hands because that would suck. But we all teach. Or most of us teach, some of us are nurses. When school starts, your schedule gets busy. I honestly wish I'd done more over the summer. I told myself I was gonna do more over the summer, but I didn't. So then, you know, you're doing it when your schedule's busy anyway. So if you don't teach this summer, get a start on it anyway. I know it doesn't fit the schedule or the timeline, but I would do some of it anyway, even if it's just reading the books, you know? And when you're reading the books, highlight or mark stuff even if you don't think you're gonna use it. Because when I told you about finding in the books how they felt it helped high achievers more than the low achievers, well, when I'm looking at my results afterwards, I get the exact opposite. But I hadn't included that in my lit review. So now I'm going back through the book trying to figure out where I found it to add it to my lit review. So even if you don't think you're gonna use it, I mean, get more information than you need. It's easier to cut it out than to go back and find it afterwards. Yeah?
What was the most rewarding part of this class for you?
The fact that it worked the way I thought. And honestly, as far as all the data goes, the student survey.
I was gonna say you had a student survey, and when you said what can we improve, two of the comments said nothing.
Yeah.
I thought it was perfect the
way
it was, so that must have been.
And they're liars because you saw the video. You know, there's room for improvement. But it was. I mean, they really liked it.
That's pretty cool.
And they, you know, again, if we think it's great, it doesn't matter. The students don't.
Right.
So, so yeah, that was probably the most rewarding is when the surveys came in and yes, they agreed with what I was thinking. And when they come up in the class afterwards and say, well, I wish there was a video for this, you know,
right.
And then tells me I need to do more of it. And actually just talking in our office, the auto repair instructor is talking about doing it next year.
Yeah.
So, you know, and career tech, I mean, a lot of times when you're talking four-year colleges or even where I work with the liberal arts side and the technical side, you know, us technical instructors are sometimes viewed as the knuckle draggers, you know, and nothing can be further from the truth, you know. After doing this, there isn't even anybody on the liberal arts side of the college that's doing this that I know of, or that has told anybody, you know, and it flat works. So, you know, that was rewarding too,
mm-hmm.
You know. It was rewarding that they were gonna have me do a presentation on this at one of our technology days, but they decided to just have liberal arts people do it, so. Yeah. Career tech, I mean, as much as we try, we're still fighting an uphill battle.
That's a losing battle.
Yep. It is terrible. It's ridiculous. I mean, you know, anybody teaching career tech can hold a candle to absolutely anybody teaching anything else. But it's just not treated the same. Because it's not high academia, you know. And I don't mean that to sound across the board, you know. I mean, there's liberal art faculty that just have a tremendous amount of respect for career tech, and just as a rule, in general, it's different. Yeah. Well, thank you. And if there are any questions, I'm happy to ask. And I'm serious too when I say if you have thoughts or questions after the fact, email me. I may not know the answer, but I'll give you something.
2-1.
Okay, that's
four.
Two.
Right in.
Two.
Two. Two. Two.
Two. Two. Two. Two.
Probably heading to tell somebody about the North American Conference.
Yeah, thank you. For the end of your course.
And I wonder why I was considered for the dean position.
Yeah.
Yes, I am.
Is your paper just a
form? You know, it's a yeah, the abstract. I haven't done the abstract. And then.